Well, artificial intelligence is going to be one of the areas to focus on as we head back into the new school year. All levels of education are taking a look at the potential of AI and what it could bring to education. But there are also some areas of potential concern.
Welcome to The Ripple Effect, the podcast that takes you on a journey through the minds of Wharton faculty. I'm your host, Dan Loney, and in each episode, we'll be diving deep into the inspiration behind the groundbreaking research that Wharton professors have conducted and exploring how their findings resonate with the world today.
Pleasure to be joined here in studio by Christian Terwiesch, who is professor and co-director of the Mac Institute for Innovation Management here at the Wharton School. Great to see you again. Thanks for having me. Thank you. And so the interesting thing is, this is something that really came into your mindset in your teaching here at Wharton. You started to see AI as a component that you needed to focus on.
Yeah, absolutely. So by way of background, many, many years ago, I have a background in computer science, even at a class on neural network. But really put this topic to the side till Thanksgiving about 2 years ago. My kids were home from college and the work, and like many other families in this country, we talked about ChatGPT. And so the topic came up like, hey, Dad, you teach at the business school. Can ChatGPT take your final exam? And so what we did is we just took my final exam in operations management for the MBA students, put it into ChatGPT, and it did pretty well. And so we put the story online, it went viral, and ever since, people believe I know something about AI.
But did it surprise you that ChatGPT was able to do well on a Wharton exam?
Absolutely. Not just that it did well, the way it answered the question, the level of sophistication of the language, the persuasiveness, the smoothness of the writing, it just blew my mind.
So how has that changed your thought process in how you teach, how you give exams? How has it impacted your operation?
Well, the first reaction is, wow, this is big, right? This is a major productivity boost. Before we talk more about teaching, let's digress a little bit in what it means to have a productivity boost, right? We're going to see productivity boosts in many industries for doctors, for nurses, for lawyers, for accountants, for radio hosts, for business school teachers, right? We're all going to get more productive. Right. But what does it mean to be more productive? So imagine, let's take a barber shop, right? I have a technology that makes a barber twice as productive. What does it mean? The barber can either make haircuts that are twice as good, or they can take twice as many customers and get a haircut, right? So I'm shifting what we call the cost-quality frontier. The cost-quality frontier is shifted out, and I can do now more with less. So what does it mean for teaching? Well, I can either teach more students, or I can hold the number of students I'm teaching constant and provide a better job.
What do you think it's going to mean most for students in terms of how they go through their education process moving forward?
I think you have to distinguish between two types of use cases, right? There's a use case for the students who get the same education as before. They just get it in a more efficient and thus cheaper way. I remember many years ago, you and I talked about massive open online learning.
Yeah.
I taught one of the first MOOCs here at Wharton. And so that was all about taking the Wharton experience and making it cheaper. Now, the other use case, and that's one I think we should be more bullish about, is we do a better job, right? The haircut looks twice as good. Mm-hmm. So we have to ask ourselves in education, what does it mean to provide education that is twice as exciting for the same number of students?
Is there a level of concern about students maybe not having the level of learning on specific topics because they're relying on the component of AI to help them through the process?
Absolutely, right? So there's a concern, just take a calculator as an example. When the calculator came out, when spell checks came out, we were concerned, and I think rightfully concerned, that students wouldn't forget how to do basic calculations and that they would weaken on their spelling. It's like if you take a pilot and the pilot is flying autopilot all the time, is the pilot at risk of forgetting how to fly an airplane? Probably.
The question of, though, the different levels of education and how they're going to be impacted, we're already seeing those types of discussions form at this point. Colleges are obviously thinking about it. Even high schools and middle schools are thinking about how AI can either be a tool to benefit the students' learning, but at the same time being careful of the component of exams and tests that they're providing to the school as well.
Yeah, so let's table the exams for just a second. Again, you mentioned colleges and K-12. I think there the impact is going to be very similar. The distinction that matters is unfortunately the rich and the poor, right? They are privileged universities and privileged private schools, Penn, Wharton being one of them. And there the question is all about, like, how can we take the students that we teach anyway and provide them a better education? Now, I'm realistic about this. There are many situations in education where money is scarce. They think about public schooling in poor areas. And there the focus will be for the politicians about how to make education cheaper.
Right.
Both of them boost the frontier. That's a good thing. But I wish there would be more people who would benefit in the way that we could benefit at Wharton.
But obviously, just when you think about K through 12, just having the access to computers and then obviously having the access to AI or ChatGPT as an assistant in, you know, doing research or doing a paper, that's a significant hindrance in many cases in different parts of the country.
I think most K-12 teachers I talk to will have the first reaction like, this is going to be problematic, right? And I think it's sure. I mean, if you have basically your brother-in-law taking the exam for you,
right,
I'm sure that is hindering the education process. And an institution like ours, we are certifying a specific skill for somebody. And if that certification is now weakened by the fact that we are not sure whether the person has a skill or the technology has a skill, we have a problem.
But I guess we shouldn't be surprised that is somewhat the reaction that we're seeing right now, is because in many cases, when we see a new technology come on the board with great potential, there is a concern. There's a hesitancy that's out there.
And it should be, right? I think, again, let's go back to calculators. When calculators, you might still remember how to do 7 times 7. Let me just do the math, right? It's 49, if I'm not mistaken. So you remember that, I remember that, but somebody who grew up in the age of the calculator, they might say, like, I don't have to know 7 times 7, I just asked the calculator.
Right.
So you can now make the same argument for ChatGPT, where you say, like, I don't know how to write an English essay, but ChatGPT can do it for me. So I think it really boils down to the question, like, what skills do we want to teach our kids, and what is the learning outcome that I want to have my students in my course?
And there's also the component of the development of the ChatGPT itself, with the different versions we've seen come out even in this short period of time, and how the technical side can improve, you know, what's available for use in and around ChatGPT.
Yeah, so I started using 3.5, version 3.5, about a year and a half, 2 years ago for my initial exam. That did pretty well already. And then with 4 coming out and 4 Turbo and now 4 Omnichannel, it just got better and better.
What are the discussions you've had with your students about the use of ChatGPT? What are the parameters and barriers that they can and cannot use?
I'm like a harsh German guy, right? So the rule is very simple. You're not allowed to use ChatGPT on the final exam. So that's the first and most important rule. The second one is you can use it for case preparation and discussion. I've seen not too many students take advantage of that, though I expect that number to be growing. So I'm totally fine if you take the case, upload it into ChatGPT, and ask for advice. I think that's fair game.
Yeah.
And then in class, we are typically not using it at all. Again, I think it works best when students prepare for the case, for an assignment, in advance of class.
So then seemingly we're looking at a time where we're going to go through a period where leadership of the education sector, whether it be colleges, universities, or school districts, are going to have long conversations about what is allowable and what is not allowable around AI.
Yeah, I wrote an op-ed on the question, like, what is allowable and not. And I think it's helpful to distinguish between 3 types of tests. The tests that you do to certify a skill, and for those, don't use ChatGPT. Then the second thing is what I oftentimes do as a teacher in class, I ask my students questions to just get a sense of how they progress on their learning journey. And again, using ChatGPT would be misleading. The third type of test is really more like a homework that is hopefully engaging the students in the learning. And for that, if I can use ChatGPT to increase that engagement, that would be a good thing. But so always ask yourself, why are you testing? Tests are not for the sake of testing. As an educator, you have to always think, like, why do I test?
How much do you think ChatGPT has impacted your profession right now?
I think we're just seeing the implications for the academic profession. I use it for idea generation oftentimes. So I've wrote a paper that shows how ChatGPT outperforms human beings at coming up with ideas for new products or services. That is something that somebody who teaches innovation cares a lot about. I use it for writing. When I'm stuck with something, I say, like, hey, ChatGPT, continue that page for me. I think the key thing that you have to realize about ChatGPT is it still makes mistakes, but there are situations where mistakes are not consequential. So if I'm asking you for 10 ideas and 5 of them are bad, I still get five good ideas. If I ask you to do heart surgery for me and five of those heart surgeries go wrong, that would be a disaster. So you want to use it in relatively low-stakes environment where you have a human in the loop so that you make sure that the quality is ultimately where you want it to be, because ultimately it's your name on the paper.
And again, if you have that understanding that things like ChatGPT can be an assistant, be a guide in the process of doing a test exam or whatever it is, but still that you have to, you know, do the double check, but, you know, fall back and make sure that everything is proper and in working order, then it could be a benefit for good moving forward.
Absolutely, right? I think if all we ended up is a world where we were 3 years or 4 years ago, we would have wasted a huge opportunity.
Where do you think we're going to go with education then longer term with things like AI and ChatGPT in the process?
So I think it's going to increase access, first of all. There are many people living in the world, that goes back to our MOOC discussion when we started the MOOCs, there are many people in the world who don't have access to an education like here at Wharton, and we can basically share and open the gates to those people. I think that's a good thing. That is all about making things more efficient. For the people who are at Wharton, I hope we can do a better job educating them. We can create some really awesome learning experiences. I know Ethan Mollick and the folks building simulations are already actively working on that. We can create real kind of increases in the quality of education, just like the person, the barbershop is providing better looks to their clients.
Christian, great to talk with you as always. Thanks very much for your time.
Thanks for having me here.
You got it. Christian Terwiesch, professor and co-director of the Mack Institute for Innovation Management here at the Wharton School.
Thank you for listening to The Ripple Effect. We hope you found this episode informative and engaging. Don't forget to subscribe and leave us a review so that we can continue to bring you the best insight from the Wharton School.